in your name? How do people that, and who are these people? These are people that aren't saved. These are unbelievers. And they say, have we not prophesied in your name? And then they say, have we not cast out demons in your name? Okay, so how do unbelievers cast out demons? And then finally, they say, and have we not done many wonders? Or a better translation of that word is miracles in your name. I imagine healings are included in that. So you've got to understand that Satan is a very, very powerful entity. And he can give the appearance of healing, and he probably can heal if God allows it. So I just wanted to clarify that point for you. And then what does Jesus say in 7:23?
That I will reply, I never knew you. Go away.
That's right.
The things you did were unauthorized.
That's right. The things that you did, I never knew you, you who practice lawlessness. And that's an important phrase, because the idea of being lawless is actually a description of Satan. He's lawless. So any other questions on that area? Just to clarify a little bit. Okay, then open your Bibles to Ephesians 6. And I'm going to start, I want us to go ahead. I'm going to inconvenience you one last time. I'm only going to read 4 verses, 6, 10 through 13. If you're ready for the Word of God, would you say amen?
6.
Would you stand 10. With me as we read the Word of God? Out of respect 13. To God's holy Word. It says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. So, thank you. You can be seated. So remember last week, we started to look at the churches in the book of Revelation, because the churches in the book of Revelation expose us to how Satan attacks believers in churches. Okay? Remember that? And we said last week that there were 7 letters written, and two were written to churches that were doing well, Smyrna and Philadelphia. And then the next church was the church at Ephesus. And what was the problem with the church at Ephesus? Do you remember? In Revelation 2, Ephesus had left their first love. Okay? And then we had just begun to discuss the church at Pergamum. Okay? And that's in Revelation 12 through 7, 2, 12 through 17, if you want to turn there. But the history of the church at Pergamum is interesting. This is a city. During this time in its history, it would be considered to be a prominent city in the Roman Empire. And there is a temple here for emperor worship. There's a temple for the Greek god Zeus. And and the city has its own god, and his name is Asclepius, and he's a healer. So they have a healing temple. It's kind of a combination healing temple and hospital. Of course, there's not much. They don't have very much knowledge of how really to treat people for illness, but that's what they do there. And let me see if I can read better with these on. Maybe. So, what you have is a very, very, because of all these temples, you have a very pagan society. And it's difficult for these Christians to live there. And in Revelation 2, where we read about this church, we see that There's even been, there have been people there that have been martyred. Who's been martyred? Does it tell us?
Antipas.
Huh? Antipas. And Antipas was the bishop of the church of Pergamum. And he was, I believe he was burned at the stake, I think. And he, you know what tradition says? The reason why they killed him is because the demons kept complaining to the priest. The demons, there were, this is a place, this is, it's referred to as the throne of Satan, something to that effect. This is, that's most probably the throne of Zeus. It was set up for human sacrifice. And it was a very, very wicked place. So this Antipas, who everywhere he went, he told people about Jesus, the demons get tired of it, so they started to incite the priest. This is what tradition says. And then the priest went ahead and had him eliminated. So, with your Bibles open to that Revelation 2, what was the fatal flaw of the church at Pergamum? If you look in that 14th...
I worship in such a son.
Okay, and when you think of those things, put them all in one big basket. They were compromised with the world around them. They had allowed the world around them to come into the church. They rather than being separated from the world, they had included the world in their worship. And you know, this isn't unusual at this time in history. When Paul writes to the church at Corinth, he writes to them about they were having orgies in the church. So people struggled with the world around them. I think Anita might have said the word immorality, and that's it. They had succumbed to immorality. So in verse 16, what does Jesus say to them?
Huh?
And?
Also, I'll come too quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth.
And what would that mean? If you were in Theology 101 and somebody made reference to the sword of Jesus' mouth, what do you think that might be?
The word of God.
The word of God. Judgment, specifically, the idea of judgment, okay? That's a very, 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 very vivid picture, especially in regards to the book of Revelation. So what's the remedy? Jesus, the good thing about this, six of the seven churches get remedies. One of them doesn't. So Jesus doesn't think real highly of their opportunity to repent. But he gives them a remedy in 16 and 17. What does he tell them to do? Okay, and then what? 17.
Anyone who is willing to hear should listen to the Spirit and understand what the Spirit is saying to the churches. Everyone who is victorious will eat the manna that has been hidden away in heaven. And I will give to each one a white stone, and on the stone will be engraved a new name that no one knows except the one who receives it.
And you know the idea behind that white stone?
Individuality, kind individuality.
Yeah, they used to give white stones to winners of athletic events in the games. The idea is it's something to aspire to, and it indicates that you have won the battle, you have become an overcomer, okay? So that's kind of the idea behind that white stone. So let's go on to the next church in 18 through 29. And this is the church at Thyatira. And this is an active working church, and they had many good works. It says, to summarize, they had love, service, faith, they were patient, but they had a flaw, and the flaw he begins to speak about that in verse 20. If you look at verse 20, what was their fatal flaw? They had become victim of a Jezebel, a false prophetess. And that person had allowed the church to be led into sin. People were, in fact, in the church committing fornication, and they were tolerating it instead of dealing with it. So what does he tell them? What's the warning he gives them in the 23rd verse? These are churches. Remember that. These are churches. Okay. 23rd verse, he tells them that in the 23rd verse, I will kill her with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the minds and the hearts. I will give to each one of you according to your works. He threatens to take her out. And see, that's what happens. Listen, that's what happens when churches refuse to deal with sin. You know what happens? When churches refuse to deal with sin, you know what God does? He sends them more sin. And then if they refuse to deal with that sin, you know what he does? He sends them more sin. He uses Satan and sends them more sin. Until Satan is willing to do that until he makes them ineffective. And then you'll see, when we get to the last church, you know what God does? He washes his hands of them. He doesn't have any use for them. If you tolerate sin in the church, that's why people are always aghast by the idea of church discipline, but it's not really church discipline. It's really church love, church restoration, and it's an expression of love for Jesus Christ, because Christ died for the church. So he has a legitimate concern about the church. And then in verses 21 and 22, he speaks of the remedy, where he speaks about what they need to do. I gave her time to repent. I'm going to cast her into a sick bed, etc., etc., etc. And it all starts, see, now remember what the first church, what was wrong with the first church? They lost their
love,
okay? And then when you lose your love, next you end up like the second church, where you begin to compromise with the world. And then when you begin to compromise with the world, what do you do next? You tolerate sin in your own midst. See, not only when Jesus wrote these letters, he showed us these sin patterns for each individual church, but these sin patterns are sequential in nature. Lose your first love, compromise with the world, you tolerate sin. This is the process by which churches and individuals lose their relationship with the Lord. Okay? Sequentially and chronologically. So go to the church at Sardis. Okay, that's in chapter 3. Starts in 3:1. Sardis was another great city of the ancient world. There's uses of the word Sardis that have to do with great wealth. Its name was synonymous with wealth. And the city and the church actually ended up, not long after this letter, they went out of, this church went out of existence. But they had a fatal flaw, and he talks about it in the first verse in the third chapter. And what does he say? They're a dead church. When it means dead, you know what it means. It means everybody was dead. It means that it was a dead church in the church. But it had a lot of activities. It says, I know your works. They had a lot of programs. But the church was dead. Because they had gone through this process. Everybody was very busy, but God wasn't living with them. He wasn't there with them. So that's why I don't believe in being program-centric. I believe in being Jesus-centric when it comes to church. To be busy and have programs isn't always all you need to do. There's other things you need to do, to. And he tells them in verses 2 and 3, he tells them to be watchful and to strengthen what little remnant there might be. So there's probably a few people still left that are still seeking the Lord, that are still trying to worship the Lord. But when you lose that first love, when you begin to compromise with the world, when the sin is tolerated in the church, and when you give in to that sin from the world, then sin will, listen, sin is not stationary. Sin is progressive in nature. If you've got sin in your life today, and if you don't get rid of it, you know what? It gets worse. Sin just doesn't sit there. Your process of sanctification is ever growing, correct? Mm-hmm. The opposite is true too. When you start to walk away from the Lord, you'll find it become much and much easier more and more you go. So the spiritual life of this church is being choked out of it. And then the final church, which is what we call the apostate church, and that's in Revelation 14 through 19. And Laodicea is really, in this part of the world, it's probably one of the chief cities. It's located at there's three highways that run right alongside the city, one from east, one from west. One goes east-west, one goes north-south, and the other one goes from the southwest to the northeast. They were famous. It was extremely wealthy. It was a banking center because of all the highways. They made a special kind of black wool there that was very highly sought at. It was a fashion center. It was a medical center. And nothing is known of the founding of the church. And Paul mentions it in Colossians in 2:1 and in 4:13 in one other place. But he'd never been there. But what we do know is that out of the seven churches, as I said, that are mentioned here in Revelation 2 and 3, this is the only church which is not given any commendation whatsoever. The Lord does not say anything good about this church. And the fatal flaw is in 3:15. And what does it say in 3:15? I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I could wish you were cold. So Jesus says, I'd rather you be, they're not cold or hot. He says, I wish that you would be cold or hot. What would cold represent?
Refreshment.
Unsaved.
I still say it means refreshment. Refreshment, nourishment.
Okay. Cold or hot. Unsaved or saved. I wish that you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm, and lukewarm then is a reference to being hypocritical, they portray themselves as being hot, but in reality, they're cold. They are, and that is considered to be the worst of the churches. They are the hypocrites that play at Christianity.
Yeah, but if they overcome, they're given the greatest promise.
Mm-hmm. And churches like this are churches that deny the Bible, the inerrancy of the Bible. They allow homosexuals into their pulpits, which is pretty common in most of the major denominations in America today. There's parts of the Christian faith that they've kind of put away. They're much more success-driven than they are missions-driven. And Jesus tells them in verses 18 and 19, he tells them to buy gold refined in the fire that you may be rich. Do you know what he means by this? Gold refined in the fire. He wants them to become positionally righteous. More in a minute. But that, to buy gold, where are they supposed to buy gold from? To buy from me gold. Christ says to buy from him gold. He wants them be saved, in other words. And he talks about a white remnant that symbolizes righteous deeds. Talks about anointing their eyes. That symbolizes the truth of God. They can see the truth when their eyes are anointed. And he tells them to be zealous and repent. Turn from sin. So God is telling them to be saved, in essence, what he's telling them as he gives them that formula to change who they are. So, I forget what I wrote in your notes. So we study these churches that we're discussing so that we can look at them and look at ourselves as individuals and look at ourselves as a church corporately. Now we know what caused their failures. They lost their first love. They ended up compromising the world. They let sin into their churches. And then they ended up being a place where their worship was totally hypocritical. So, are there any questions in regards to that first section? That's the first part of the study. Now we're going to go to Ephesians 6. We'll pretty much stay there for the rest of the study. Any questions or comments? Anybody?
So, like I said before, it's fascinating that this last church, if they overcome, they're given the greatest promise. Yeah. This is Christ's name, it's promise.
Well, I think any believer is given that promise. Any believer sits with Christ on his throne, as Christ sits with his Father on the throne. There's a revelation. So look at the first thing I want to talk about then in Ephesians 6 is our position. Now in the book of Ephesians is written very, very pointedly. And Paul presents the great reality. He likes to use the phrase of being in Christ, what it means to be a believer, what it means to belong to God, to have the indwelling Spirit of God, and to become adopted into God's family. And the first three chapters of Ephesians comprise one of the greatest statements in the Bible on positional truth. Okay? Positional truth. Our identity in Christ. It tells us that Ephesians, the last part of the third verse in the first chapter of Ephesians says, we are blessed with all spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Did you know today, if you're saved, you are blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places? Okay? That's not written in a future text. Tense. It's written in the present tense, okay? You have been given the adoption. You have been loved by the Father. You are predestined. You are forgiven. You are enlightened. You are knowledge. You have the knowledge as long as you use it. You have the understanding and you have the power. So you have been placed into the kingdom of Christ. That's positional righteousness, okay? You have been placed into the position of Christ. You've been ushered into a union with the Trinity and with every other believer. I was talking to somebody at lunch today, and we were talking about how when you talk to a fellow believer, you don't even need to talk about Christ. It's somebody you've never met before, and it will become obvious to you because your spirit communicates with their spirit, and it will become obvious to you that they're a believer. And conversely, if you talk to a non-believer long enough, it should be, it will become obvious to you that they're a non-believer. As long as you're exercising the spirit of discernment in your life, you have to exercise it. You have to try to understand. You have to ask the Lord to make you a good discerner of people. But all this has been done, this positional righteousness has been done according to the tremendous purpose of God in the mystery of the church, as he has made us one in Christ. And what's God's purpose for our life? The purpose of man is to
glorify God.
Yeah. Never forget that. The sole purpose of man, in the Westminster Catechism, it says that the purpose of man is to glorify God. The purpose of man is to glorify God. So, Paul begins Ephesians with speaking of our position in the first three chapters. Then he goes through the next three chapters, 4, 5, 5, and 6. And he talks about our practice, the way we are to live as Christians, our lifestyle. As Christians, we're to be different than the world's lifestyle. It seems like our churches want to reflect the world's lifestyle, but we're supposed to be different. Ours is to be, it's called a worthy walk, a walk of a oneness with the Lord, a walk of unity with the Lord, a walk of love with the Lord, a walk of light, a walk of wisdom, a spirit-controlled walk. In our relationships, when's the last time you heard divorce spoken against from the pulpit? Pastors won't even waste their breath anymore. We don't worry about divorce anymore. You know, we don't even talk about divorce anymore. You know, we got bigger fish to fry. The problem is the reason we get the bigger fish to fry is because of the other fish that we've already thrown out of the kitchen because they stink. Divorce is one of those fishes. You know, our marriages are supposed to be different. Our families are supposed to look different. Our employment conditions should be different. Everything about us should be different. And all of those principles and standards by which the believer is to function in the world are totally unique to Christians, different than everybody else. So if you want to know how you're supposed to conduct yourself in the world, all you got to read is 4, 5, and 6 of Ephesians, and you'll be set. But Paul wants you to, he wants to help you, because if you understand your position, and if you understand your practice, then you need what happens in chapter 6. He tells us that we all have the resources, we all have the power, we all have the principles to live like Christians. However, he wants you to know one more thing. He wants you to know that, listen to me, the Christian life is not easy. He wants you to know that. He wants you to understand that. If it was easy, he wouldn't have wrote this last part of chapter 6. He wants you to understand, even though we have the power, even though we have the principles, our enemy Satan is going to try to stop God's purpose in our lives. So in defining the Christian life, the best term to use, and Paul is the one that adopts this theology, is an idea of warfare. He uses that idea purposefully. He doesn't use it willy-nilly. Paul says what he needs. Repeatedly in Scripture, the Christian life is seen in terms of warfare. Whether you're at the beginning of your Christian experience or at the end of your Christian experience, you're going to have the same battle. And if you think it's going to get any easier, guess what? You're wrong. The more effective you become as a Christian, the harder that Satan is going to work against you. Did you know that? And you know who often your worst enemies are? Your fellow Christians. Yeah. They'll defame you. They'll slander you. They'll speak ill of you to other people. Isn't it amazing how Satan can use, even in safe people, there's areas of oppression that he can use for his own agenda. But it's always been a war, and it's never going to stop being a war, so expect the war. However, the longer you fight, I believe the more effective you become at fighting, the more victories you will gain, and after you string together victories, the more confidence you'll have in future fights. But you have to begin to fight. If you think that you can just sit idly by and everything's going to be hunky-dory, the Christian church in America has been doing that for about 100 years. How's that working out for them? You know, the idea of warfare used to be taught and preached in all our churches. Now it's hardly taught and preached anywhere because it makes people uncomfortable. So to develop a war, to understand a war, you have to understand your enemy. And I've talked in regards to this many, many times. Our enemy is He wants to destroy within us every divine purpose. He understands that we're sons and servants, and he wants to come against us in this area of being a soldier. And we're not, you're not, so you're a soldier, but it's not simply a physical fight. It does have a physical element to it, okay? Because Satan can make you sick, okay? He can make you sick by the things you do to yourself. He can place things in your path that'll make you sick, okay? So it has a physical element, but the real war is fought in the spiritual realm. The realm all around us here this evening that we don't see. So Satan will use physical warfare against you to get to his end, and he is the force behind all that warfare. But the real battle is fought in the spiritual realm. And we face an enemy who is strong, he's clever, he's deceiving, he's subtle. And if you and I are going to fulfill our potential in the Lord, we have to know the fullness of victory of our true Christian living. We have to listen to what Paul says at the end of this book. And so, we want to just start with these first three verses, and I'm not going to get very far. I'm only going to look at this first portion. But in Ephesians, then, in 6, in verse 10, Paul says, "Finally, my brethren," and so, okay, he's written over 6 chapters, and now he says, "Finally, my brethren," okay? He's talking to his brothers in the Lord. He's written over 6 chapters, and this is the closing thought. He says, "Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might." Okay? Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. 2 phrases. In the Lord and in the power of his might. And throughout Ephesians, we are told that we are in Christ. Remember? He says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And what that means is that we are one with him. His life, Jesus Christ's life, is to be your life. His power is to be our power. His truth is our truth. In other words, it is because we are in Christ. You don't get to be strong against Satan by yourself. You get to be strong against Satan because you are in Christ. That's why you're strong. So as a general principle of living, we have to, as a child of God, you have to depend on God. You can't depend on anything else, okay? And I've got some scriptures there for you. 1 John 4:4. "Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world," okay? God is so much more powerful than Satan. We just don't use that power. The smallest amount of divine power can overcome the greatest amount of the power of hell.
Amen.
How is Satan going to be incarcerated? He's going to be incarcerated by a fellow angel. God's not going to do it. He doesn't need to do it. Jesus Christ isn't going to do it. He doesn't need to do it. It's going to be another angel that's going to incarcerate him in hell. That's who takes him to hell and binds him up for 1,000 years. He has the key. God gives him the key, and he throws him in his temporary position as God assumes his reign on earth for 1,000 years. Hebrews 2:14. At the cross, Jesus Christ gave a death blow to Satan that he might, it says, destroy him that had the power of death. So Satan has no one to fear. Satan had the power over death, but does he have it now?
No.
Not in the life of a believer, he doesn't have it. And then in Ephesians 3:20, it speaks about, "Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly," that phrase, exceedingly abundantly, you know what that means? A whole bunch. I would put a whole bunch, but Paul likes long words, exceedingly abundantly. "Above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, God has given us through Christ the resource for our victory. So if you dwell on those, even just those three scriptures, if you're confronted in spiritual warfare, and if you start studying those scriptures, and it's a good thing to pray them over your children, then you can start to have a greater knowledge of the victory that Jesus Christ has for you in the battle that will ensue as you attempt to follow the Lord on a daily basis. Okay? That's all I got tonight.